security, yeah, yeah. I want some security.
This video shows the majority of tasks related to running the Guardium data encryption in version 3.0. GDE is a third-party solution, and access to installation files requires generating an account on the IBM partner's website. Therefore, the first installation task is to download the IBM GDE enabler from the IBM software access page. In most cases, it will be Passport Advantage. The name of downloaded archive may differ from the one I used, but after unpacking, it should contain two bin files and a short document describing how to use these tools. For unknown reasons, both tools only work on Red Hat and CentOS version 6 or 7. The GDE 3.0 bin tool is used to download the license key by accepting the license agreement. The generated key will be used at a later time. The second tool allows us to register the user's account on the partner's website, where the proper software is available. You must provide information about the user and the name of the customer. The result of the operation is a file containing credentials to GDE software download page. The link to software download page is pointed in the README file of the enabler package. On the website, select Need an Account option and register your account using the generated data and specify a password. The account name is the email address given in the enabler. After logging in, we have access to all solutions in the Guardium data encryption package, with the division into a version. We are expanding a subgroup with the latest version of GDE 3.0. We will be interested in four sections from the list. Data Security Manager section includes installation files for Appliance and its upgrades. The installer is available in OVA, ISO and KVM formats. Upgrades have a tar extension. To download the required file, we indicate it and use the download button. It's also worth downloading the documentation and agents for the operating systems on which we plan to install solution. We find them in the documentation and transparent encryption sections accordingly. At the moment, there are two major versions of agent available, 5 and 6. Agents release 5.x refers to GDE2. Agents release 6.x supports GDE3. There is a backward compatibility of GDE3 to agents 5.x. The main difference between GDE3 and 2 is LDT, Live Data Transformation feature. For Solaris, AIX and HPUX systems, agents are available in version 5 only. Whether we have the right to use the LDT functions for Windows and Linux, we always install the latest agent in version 6. If we need an agent in version 5, we are looking for it first for the latest GDE3, and if it's not there, we search the latest version of GDE2. Additionally, download from VDS Compatibility Matrices section the latest document to check OS version, kernel and file system supportability. GDE has two-layer architecture and consists of agents installed on systems where data is encrypted and appliances called DSN, responsible for policy configuration and cryptographic infrastructure. At the beginning, we will install an appliance that will perform the primary function in the cluster, which will be configured later. We will use the OVA installer, which provides a predefined hardware configuration. I'm importing an OVA file. In my environment as a hypervisor, I use VMware Workstation. The amount of RAM and CPU can be changed later, but in the pre-configured configuration, there is 250 gigs disk which cannot be changed. The requirements for DSM are not exorbitant and are related to the planned number of agents that will be served by the environment. I'm starting the installation, which will take 30-40 minutes. The installation process is fully unattended. DSM, unlike collectors in the Guardium Data Protection solution, don't have a built-in analytical engine. Even if you use this solution to monitor file access, events should not be collected on DSM. Therefore, DSM does not have large disk requirements, and also disk performance is not a key element of the infrastructure. DSM has FIPS 140 Level 1 certification, which among other things prevents the user from accessing the operating system layer. Now we are ready to configure our primary DSM. To configure network services, I log into a CLA admin account with one-time password CLA admin 123. The new password must be strong and contain at least one capital letter, a number and special character. The command line interface has a sub-level command structure similar to most network devices. To configure IP addressing, I go to the network subcommand. Pressing tab displays a list of available commands. Tab is also used to automatically complete the command being entered. By default, after the installation, the first network interface is configured using DHCP, but in my installation, I will use a static configuration. I'm disabling the DHCP configuration on the ETH0 interface and configuring the address IP. Installation with OVA includes two network interfaces, which allows them to be bonded. But in the case of virtualization, it doesn't make much sense. The next step is to determine the default gateway and verify the correctness of the configuration. I'm pinging local interface, gateway and host outside the local subnet. Everything looks OK. My appliance has access to the machines and the packets are properly routed. It's recommended, after changing the network configuration, to restart the services. For this purpose, I go to the system commands and run the restart command. The rest of configuration can be carried out remotely via SSH. The next step are DNS settings. It's extremely important to ensure proper name resolution for all elements of GDE solution. In the situation that it's impossible to use DNS, you should set up resolving for each GDE asset using the command host in the network command group. In turn, I point the time server and change the time zone adequate to my environment. Time synchronization is a critical element that allows the use of audit logs as a trace of user activity. Changing the time zone can cause an automatic logout because some shell monitoring processes may not be aware of this change, so I recommend restarting the services again. Next, I configure the hostname, which must be properly resolved. The final step at this stage will be to generate certificates for communication with the outside world. This command is run only on DSM, performing the primary function. As part of the parameters, we insert a description of the certificate used to present our service. The basic configuration has been done. We can log in to the GDE portal. The newly installed DSM has a built-in GUI account, admin, with OTP password admin123. Dashboard presents basic configuration information. To get access to further configuration, we need to enter the license key gathered before using enabler. I recommend using named accounts for access to CLI. To do this, we use a set of commands within the command user subgroup. Our primary DSM has been configured. Due to nature of the solution, which is data encryption, it is absolutely necessary to configure additional DSM that will act as a backup server in the event that the first server is unavailable. We name this additional appliance as a DSM failover. In large DSM installations, failover is also used to handle the requests of agents coming from the subnets closest to its location in order to distribute traffic and ensure low latency in responses. In my example, the second DSM will be installed using the ISO installer. In this case, we can define the size of the disk, which I set to 100 GB. The installation process is also fully unattended. I have also configured network settings. In this case, do not execute the genca command. We will configure the cluster a different way. Before we set up the connection between primary and failover DSM, we must open network ports to make this communication allowed. Here, the list of ports used in DSM to DSM communication. Information exchange between appliance in the HA configuration takes place through encrypted content, but it is also possible to use an encrypted information channel. The TLS HA command is used for this. In addition, we can choose a cryptographic algorithm used in the communication channel, RSA or ECC. This choice applies to entire information exchange, also between the user and DSM as well as DSM and agents. The SUDB command is used to determine the cryptography algorithms. It has three possible values: compatible, which is default, SUDB, and RSA. Personally, I recommend using the default configuration, where web access uses RSA by default, and it is possible to communicate using ECC, and the remaining elements use an algorithm based on elliptic curves. In the case of SUDB setting, only elliptic curves cryptography is used. And when the value is set to RSA, all elements use the Rives-Shamir-Adleman algorithm. I enable channel encryption between DSMs and check algorithm settings. Then on DSM primary, I add the DSM failover configuration by providing a resolvable machine name. Now we can define our second appliance as a failover using the convert to failover command. We will provide certificate description again. A correctly added DSM will be updated in the HA view on the primary DSM with marked flag registered. Last step is to run synchronization between the appliances. We select the DSM failover and press the config replication button. After a while, the flag configure should also be selected. The synchronization status marked with a yellow triangle means that the initial synchronization has not yet been fully completed. After a few minutes, the status should change to green circle, and information about the time of the last synchronization will appear. We can now log into the DSM failover portal. Note that the header has information about the DSM failover role and the read-only operation mode. In GDE, configuration changes can only be made on the primary server, in the vast majority of cases, but a bit later. In this way, we have finished the configuration of two DSMs in cluster mode, and we can proceed to agent installation, but this requires a few additional steps earlier. GDE supports multi-tenant configuration. Data related to encryption, keys, policies, agents, and users can be managed and stored in the independent databases as part of a sync solution installation. This tenant is called in GDE as a domain. If there is no need to separate the GDE data, we create only one domain. Due to the separation of domains, we distinguish three types of Guardium administrators. The system administrator is responsible for all aspects of DSM infrastructure: configuration, update, and identity management. The predefined user admin is the system administrator. In addition, system administrator creates the domain and assigns the first administrator to them. When the first administrator is assigned to the domain, all aspects related to its management are outside the jurisdiction of the system administrator. I recommend creating at least one named system administrator and disabling the admin account from normal use. The domain administrator is responsible for domain configuration, i.e. primarily for the management of users within its scope, the configuration of auxiliary services, and ensuring correct backup and recovery. The domain administrator does not have access to data related to encryption, keys, policies, agents inside domain. The last type of user is the security administrator, responsible for implementing encryption services and managing agents within the domain. For this type of administrator, there is the possibility of granulating rights, for example, only access to keys. If local resources do not allow separation of domain and security administrator functions, it is also possible to combine both roles. If multi-tenancy is not implemented, it is possible to combine all three roles within one administration account. Each user can be switched to read-only mode, with no possibility of making any changes, so we can create some kind of the auditor role. There is no restriction on the participation of the same administrator within several domains, but this must be approved under particular domain. The administrator's identity is managed globally and can be only created by system administrator. It can be managed in GDE itself by adding it from the administrator menu. The password entered is OTP. At the moment of creating the identity, we define its function. The assignment cannot be changed later. GDE allows you to use an external identity source, LDAP or RADIUS. In my case, I use Active Directory. All the time, you should have minimum one local account to avoid problems with GDE management when there is no access to external identity provider. This time I will import the identity from Active Directory. I will define two of them as domain administrators. And two more as a security one. Then I create the first domain and I point its first administrator. All existing domain administrators appear in the list. After assigning an administrator to the domain, the system administrator can no longer manage user in it. There is only the option of deactivating them in case of complete disaster when there is no access to any existing credential inside problematic domain. I create another domain and assign the same administrator to it. I log into the domain as an end user. He is assigned to two domains, and if I don't select the domain context, it will be logged into the last domain to which he was added. End identity is managed in GDE itself, so the user has to reset the password the first time he log on. After logging in, we notice a different menu options and notification about the current domain context. Because Andrew is the administrator of many domains, he can switch between them. As the domain administrator, Andrew is responsible for the configuration of subsequent administrators. When security administrator is added to the domain, Zechmigiero, Andrew can generally specify the scope of security administrator responsibility. In addition, Andrew adds the second domain administrator to GN domain, Andrzej W. At the end, Andrew in the second domain adds to it the domain administrator, mLucas. mLucas user cannot switch between domains because he belongs only to one. mLucas has the ability to manage administrators and remove Andrew from it and adds a security administrator, pNovak. Now I'm logging in as a security administrator. This time the menu contains completely new options related to the configuration of encryption. Security admin can also switch domain if he has access to more than one of them. The configure DSM cluster allows us to go to the installation of agents. The installation process consists of two steps, installing the binaries and registering the agent in the domain. Communication between DSM and agent is limited to several ports. Only port 7024 is for calls initiated from DSM. In case it is not possible to open incoming connection to the machine on which we install the agent, we can restrict communication to outgoing ports, but it will not be possible to perform push operations from DSM to the agent. In this configuration, the agent will check the configuration changes periodically. One-way communication. Ports 8443 and 8444 are used only if we set the SUDB parameter to RSA, and ports 8446 and 8447 for compatible and SUDB settings. In order to simplify agent management, it is possible to group them in the host group. This is very important when we plan to manage hundreds or more agents. There are two methods of agent registration. Fingerprint and shared secret. We'll start with the first, less frequently used. To do this, the security administrator must register the name of the agent being installed in the domain. In the registration allowed agents option, we set the FS option. The key option is related to other solutions where DSM only serves as a key manager, for instance, tokenization server. If you want the installed agent to automatically download the policies after installation, check the Communication Enable option. With this option, we can fully control what machines will have access to our keys and policies, because the agent can only be registered when we have been added to the host list by the security administrator, and then after verification of attached host, he can also determine whether he trusts installation and allows communication between DSM and the agent. It is worth noting that the default port for push 7024 can be changed for each agent. I'm starting to install the agent. On the server, there is an agent installer for the selected platform, Red Hat 7, and I run the installation with root privileges. The installation of binaries is fully unattended and will end with a question about moving to the registration phase. To register an agent, we must provide the name primary DSM and then select the name of the agent that will be used during registration. In the case of fingerprint registration, it must be exactly the name we introduced earlier in the hosts menu. Then we display the type of registration and decide whether the change of the hardware configuration, fingerprint, will automatically force the agent for re-registration process. It is anti-spoofing protection feature. GDE supports virtualization based on Linux Docker, which is not necessary in this case. The next question is related to the LDT functionality. If our system is licensed to use LDT and we intend to use this feature, we confirm the choice. In the course of finalizing the registration, a message appeared that the port 7024 is unavailable on the machine where we install an agent from DSM. The registration process allows you to continue, but be aware that push mechanism will not be enabled. The reason for the problem in my case is the lack of correct rules in the system firewall. That's why I stopped the installation and modified the settings. A frequent mistake is an attempt to re-register an agent by reinstalling it. I strongly advise against this approach. On some platforms, such a process may require a restart of the machine to remove system kernel modules or drivers. The agent allows you to re-register at any time using the register_host tool. I answered the questions again and this time the process is successful with a request to confirm by the person installing the agent that the fingerprint of the attached DSM is compatible with the given by GDE security administrator. Thanks to this, we can confirm on both sides that the agent has been installed on the correct machine and connected to the proper DSM. The simplest confirmation of the correctness of the installation is the use of the Agent Health tool available in the agent's home directory. Information about registration, correct installation of the system kernel module, and communication with DSMs should contain the message OK. In turn, I will register the agent using the shared secret method. It is based on trust through defined code passed to the administrator installing the agent. It is also possible to provide additional security by forcing registration with the previously entered name. Shared secret can be defined globally or independently for each group of hosts if you want to automatically assign an agent to a specific group. This is the method I will use in the next example. I will start by adding two groups, Lin and Win, which will contain the Linux and Windows machines accordingly. After creating the group and re-editing it, we can define shared secret. For installation, the security administrator provides the person installing the agent with information about the primary DSM name, domain name, group name, and shared secret code assigned to it. The installation looks identical to the previous one, but at the time of registration, it is possible to identify target host by any name under the condition of the name routability between the agent and DSM. After selecting registration via shared secret, we must enter the code and domain and host group names. The other options remain the same. At the end, we confirm the state of the agent after installation. Security administrator can check registered machines in the host menu. As we can see, the machine has been assigned to the Lin group. Let's also look at installing the agent on Windows platform. It is a wizard-based installer. Similarly to the Linux process, after the installation of binaries, the agent registration option appears. I choose the shared secret registration method and enable the option of using LDT. I enter the registration information, including host group, primary DSM, and agent machine name identification. In the case of the Windows platform, a message will appear asking you to restart the system. This is necessary due to specific nature of the I/O implementation on Windows OS and driver installation responsible for encryption. Therefore, the installation of the agent on this platform should be synchronized with the planned maintenance downtime. After restarting, the GDE agent icon will appear in the system tray. Among the options, we find the possibility of re-registering the agent and getting information about its status. In the GDE console, we notice the newly added machine with the assignment to the Win group. In this way, we carried out a full GDE installation, including agents and DSMs. However, it's worth taking a few more administrative aspects. The encryption algorithm used by GDE portal depends on the suite B settings described earlier, and so by default and in the case of RSA setting, the RSA encryption with the signature SHA 384 bits is used. If we set suite B, only the ECDSA algorithm will be available. When the system works in default settings, in addition to default connection using the RSA, it is also possible to use ECC. Technically, RSA works on port 8445 and is the default HTTPS redirection for compatible NRSA modes. And for EEC, port 8448 is used, which is default when we exclude the possibility of using cryptography based on the RSA algorithm. Personally, I don't see the real need to switch to ECC. especially since we don't plan to connect to the GDE portal from smartphones or small IoT devices. DSM, after installation, uses a self-signed RSA certificate. The default compatible settings also mean that we can connect to DSM on port 8448, and then the encryption algorithm is EC-DSA. In order to change it to our certificates, we need to generate CSRs. The web certificates menu contains information about currently used certificates, and we can download a request file via the CSR generation tab. It has the form of a zip archive because, depending on the settings, it contains one or two elements. Because we operate in compatible mode, there are two files in the archive: T-server CSR request for the RSA algorithm and EC-T-server CSR associated with the ECC1. As I mentioned before, I don't see the need to use the ECC algorithm, therefore I sign the certificate only for RSA and import it into DSM. We must provide our CA certificate and a generated certificate based on CSR. Both should be exported in PEM format. After accepting new settings, the service will be rebooted. Few minutes later, on refresh screen, we should be able to log in to DSM again. After checking the certificate, we notice that the certificate changed to just imported one. If the user workstation trusts CA from the imported certificate, after passing over the URL with the machine name, the message above the faulty certificate will not appear again. I intentionally does not propose to perform the same activities on DSM failover. Incidentally, this is one of the few changes that can be made on failover server. The reason for intentional omission of this task is, in my opinion, an inconsistent implementation of failover DSM reconnecting to the primary DSM in the upgrade procedure. I'll mention this later, but this process causes regeneration of failover DSM certificates, including those used by web server. The result of this approach is the need to generate CSRs and certificates for each DSM on each upgrade. Due to occasional need to get access to the failover DSM portal, I suggest that you should leave self-signed certificates there. Multi-tenancy forces the system to provide proper backup and disaster recovery procedures. For this reason, in GDE we distinguish two types of backups: global and domain. For global backups, all domains, users, and most of auxiliary configurations are subjected to archiving. Global copies are used for the overall system recovery after a full DSM failure. Only system administrators have the right to create and restore global copies. Domain copies contain information about data within a specific domain and are managed by domain administrators. The purpose of backup of domain is the ability to restore its contents without having to perform the sweeping of all data, including other domains whose state is consistent and doesn't require replacement actions. Regardless of the backup type, they are always encrypted using a key generated independently for each domain and global backup. The key used to create backup is called the wrapper key. Wrapper keys management is one of the most important tasks of system and domain administrators. Backup can be run manually on demand with the option of store data via a browser or configure in a schedule with saving data on a remote disk using Windows Share or SCP. Restoring the backup requires that the wrapper key used in the recovery procedure suits the one used during the backup. Presented examples will concern domain backup, but they look the same for global one, with the difference that the task is performed by the system administrator and a wider range of data is archived. After switching to wrapper key management option, a message will appear asking you to create a key. There are three operations to choose from: import, export, and create. The create option is used to create a new key, including replacement of existing one. Information about the new key appears on the screen. Each time you create a new key, you must export it. Export doesn't mean creating a physical copy of the key, but only ensuring its recovery on the basis of data possessed by a specific group of administrators, the so-called key shares. The minimum custodians needed and total number of custodians options are used to determine the number of administrators who must participate in order to recreate the wrapper key. In this simple example, the key will be shared with both existing administrators, but only one of them is required to restore the key. The task is performed by user AndrzejW. When the key is exported, an additional information, wrapper key share, will appear in the administration dashboard. The administrator is responsible for copying this information and storing it outside the GDE system. Then, administrator Andrew backup the domain. I recommend adding a wrapper key signature to the backup filename because it will make it much easier to restore if the wrapper key will change in time. In the case of automatic backups, you can use the date of creation of the archive, assuming that the administrators will have their key shares also easily identified over the period of their possession. Personally, I miss a clear information in GDE about the backup file and associated with it a wrapper key. After some time, the administrator AndrzejW changes the wrapper key. It should be remembered that changing the key requires re-exporting and specifying the condition for the wrapper key recovery. Then Andrew receives the task of domain restore. Thanks to prefix, we immediately notice the incompatibility of the wrapper key, which leads to an enigmatic message about the problem with the restored operation. We need to recover the correct wrapper key. The administrator inputs his key share. Our policy allows to use only one key share source. After confirming the import operation, information about the change to the previous wrapper key will appear. It should be remembered that the operation of restoring the older key should be correlated by the administrator with the preservation of key share of currently used wrapper key, if not done before. This time the domain configuration was restored successfully. Finally, let's take a look at the process of recovery wrapper key with the participation of two custodians. The D5A710 wrapper key is exported to dhearn and jmerc administrators. The share keys are completely different. We change the wrapper key, and then we try to recover the previous one. Administrator dhearn inputs his key share and is unable to restore the wrapper key. Then jmerc adds the second share key and in effect is able to restore the previous wrapper key. The idea of key shares is very effective in multi-tenancy environments, where both parties, for example the customer and the entity maintaining the system, are responsible for the critical recovery of the sensitive data. The backup stored in file can be restored only with cooperation with data owner. The agent is always registered on the primary DSM, but in the HA environment, information about additional failover DSMs is sent to the agent configuration. If the agent cannot communicate with the primary DSM, we'll automatically switch to one of the available failover DSMs. This solution is efficient and doesn't require additional configuration. By default, after installing the agent, primary DSM is the preferred appliance and the rest performs an alternative function. If you are dealing with different sites to ensure DSM availability, it will be critical to place at least one DSM failover in each location. Agent DSM preference does not change, but you should consider the benefits of DSM proximity in the location where the agent is located. First of all, if the agent would use the local DSM as default one, it would be possible to reduce delay in key access. For this reason, it is possible to change the assignment of the preferred DSM for the agent. Instead of referring to primary DSM, he will send requests to the local failover one. Also, policy updates and agent configurations will be delivered by default from a new assigned device. Only the system administrators can change the assignment of agents to DSM, because it's related to the hardware architecture for which they are responsible. Selecting DSM, a list of agents assigned to it appears. In the case of primary DSM, the list can be empty because the agent communicates with it by default. Then, using Add button, we can specify a list of agents that should prefer the indicated DSM. After approval, the information should be sent to the GDE infrastructure. If the changes are not properly synchronized, for example, one of DSM has stopped being available, we can bypass the current settings and send the global push operation with an update to all agents via the Notify All Hosts button. However, host assignment brings with it a difficulty in managing the system through the primary DSM portal. After logging into the domain on primary DSM, we notice that the agent assigned to the failover DSM does not allow to determine us the state of its synchronization. Message not assigned to this server. In order to be able to check the status, we need to log into a specific failover DSM. To check the preferred DSM from the agent level, use the vmseg vmconfig command. The SRV URL parameter lists all nodes DSM starting from the preferred one. In addition to assignment associated with reduced delays in communication with DSM, there are two more situations where this configuration should be considered. If both sides communicate with each other through untrusted networks, we would probably want to restrict agent B to site 1 communication, only to necessary agent registration during installation. By assigning a failover DSM from the local network, we will avoid attempts to access data on the remote primary DSM. You probably noticed that in this configuration, in site B, we should put one more failover DSM to ensure that the solution will work if one of them will fail. Also, we can consider DSM assignment because the locally preferred DSM will protect us from sending agent logs to the remote one. As I mentioned earlier, DSM should never be used as a log collector, but sometimes it is necessary to collect logs. Good example is troubleshooting. So the temporary switching to the local DSM can greatly simplify the log collection. To sum up, if our configuration is not dispersed, host assignment should not be used. In other cases, consider the benefits against the less centralized solution administration. We are starting to upgrade DSMs. For example, the installation consists of 3 devices and all agents prefer primary DSM. Do we need to pass agents to other DSMs in case we are upgrading preferred one? Generally, this is not necessary. The agent will automatically move to the next DSM. However, we should be sure that other DSMs are available to the agent when it's updated. Especially in distributed environments, you should update the device after the device so that at least one DSM is always available. Other solutions may use DSM as a key manager without the support of the failover mechanism. Then they should be reconfigured so that they are switched to another device during the DSM upgrade time. A good example is tokenization server. I assume that even when you are optimistic, you make backups. But for the reminder, I would like to stress that the update procedure should only be run if we have a fresh global copy of data that will be able to recover the system in case of problems. The upgrade procedure requires stopping the replication process from the primary server to all failover DSMs. Replication does not change agent configuration, but only prevents synchronization of changes between DSMs. Interrupting the sync implies that for the duration of the entire system upgrade, the domain and security administrators do not change any settings or policies. The updating process starts with the primary DSM, which is related to its unavailability for the time necessary to perform the procedure. During this time, the agent who connects to the device being updated will notice the lack of its availability and will automatically use one of the other DSM. After the primary DSM update has finished, it will report again and the agents will start using it if needed. Now we can update the failover DSM using the same flow. When the failover DSM is updated to the same version as the primary DSM, we can reconfigure the data synchronization again. In turn, we can proceed to update the other DSMs. If there are many geographically dispersed environments, ensure that at least one local DSM is available to agents. Personally, I recommend updating one after the other. Each time we update subsequent DSM, we restore synchronization with the primary. I proceed to upgrade as a system administrator. I downloaded the new version from software download portal and stopping syncing between DSMs. This should be done for all failover DSMs. Under no circumstances may failover DSM be removed from the configuration. This may result in the lack of DSM access and solution will stop work during upgrade. I choose DSM failover and run the procedure using the cleanup replication button. The register and configure fields will be unchecked at the selected DSM. Then I go to the upgrade settings. DSM has two partitions, with the currently used version and the previous one. Additional partition allows you to return to previous version in the event of unsuccessful update. In my case, this is the first upgrade after a fresh DSM installation and therefore it's empty. If the idle partition is busy, release it using the delete idle partition button. We point the file containing the new version, tar file. A message appears reminding you that the backup should be performed, and then we confirm the initiation of the update process. After a few minutes, the browser window should be refreshed, and a login screen should appear with a message about the successful upgrade operation. As you can see, in the partition description, the new version occupied partition number 2 and has the status in use. We can proceed with the failover DSM upgrade procedure now, which is limited only to showing the update file and running the process. After confirming the failover DSM portal availability, we can re-enable synchronization between DSMs. The synchronization means running the convert to failover command on the just updated failover DSM. In the HA window on the primary server, information about the additional DSM registration will appear again, and we can enable the data replication process between them. In this way, we have completed the DSM upgrade. One more information. If you set up web certificates for failover DSM, you'll notice a problem logging back in. As mentioned earlier, the procedure of enabling desynchronization was again used by the convert to failover command, which unfortunately regenerated self-signed web certificates. To reuse the failover DSM with our own certificates, we must download CSRs, generate certificates and load them again. From my perspective, if you don't use host assignment, you should leave web certificates on failover DSMs unchanged. Agent update is fully unattended and in most cases does not cause any problems, but several rules should be followed. Always install the latest agent version. The update should be performed in the maintenance service window, because the update may require in certain situations the system restart, for instance changing the system kernel, changing the module or driver. Services using encrypted data should be stopped during the update. The update must be performed by the operating system administrator. Only kernel update on Linux can be problematic. Imagine a situation in which it is necessary to update the Linux system including the kernel, switching from kernel X to Y. And the actual install agent is in the version A. The correct scheme is as follows. We check whether the currently installed agent supports the kernel that will be installed. If so, we are updating the system and after the restart the agent will work properly. If the agent does not support the new kernel, we first update the agent to the newer version supporting the new version of the kernel, and then we update the system and restart it. This approach must be entered into system procedures for Linux administrators. Let's follow this situation. I noticed that there is an update containing a new version of the kernel. From the agent's compatibility documents, downloaded from the software portal, we learn that the kernel 3.10.0.95751 is supported from the agent version 6.1.2.22. Unfortunately, new versions of agents are not stored with the release notes, And if there is a situation that the latest compatibility document will not be available, I advise you to open a ticket or use online support to confirm the correct agent release. Then I download agent 61222. According to procedure, I update the agent. After a while, a message appears about the correctly completed process. So I can update the operating system. After the system reboots, it works on the new kernel and with the new version of the agent. And the agent communicates the loaded GDE module correctly. Uninstalling an agent is a very simple process. Let's look at it on the Linux platform. A running agent uses kernel modules in the file encryption operations. There are secvm2 and secfs2 modules. To remove an agent, run an install command located in the agent's home directory, but be sure to enter the full path. After a while, we receive confirmation of the successful agent removal. We can notice that also the modules have been properly unloaded from the system kernel. My system didn't use any encryption policies, but it may happen that the uninstallation will not force the modules to be unloaded immediately. But this is not a problem and they will be removed after a next planned reboot. In the case of Windows, to uninstall the agent we use the standard software management feature. I choose the Vormetric file system agent and run the uninstallation. Full removal of the agent requires a restart, but isn't absolutely necessary, and we can wait with it for the planned restart. So, I hope that this guide will allow you to carry out the GDE installation quickly and without any problems, and I expect your opinions and comments. Don't forget to enable follow feature of this channel and my blog. Secure.